It's not a cliche, it's a reality. That he was beaten beyond recognition. Literally beat to death, crucified. Took punishment that we should have gotten. In our place, he took it. So God, I thank you this morning. We thank you. Corporately, we thank you, God. We're connected by technology. But we thank you, Father, this morning for what you've done. Jesus, thank you for giving your life. Thank you for going back to heaven, God sending the Holy Ghost so we can live and navigate successfully in this life. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You know, Lord told me a couple years ago, I told a fellow that was working there at the time, Adam, and I said, technology is a sign that you have a relationship. In other words, technology should be a sign that you're connected to somebody. Technology now is meant to connect people, not just to do work. So thank God for some technology this morning. Amen. At this time, we got a special. We're going to share with you the kids' video. You know, we sent out and asked the parents if they'd just video a little bit of their kids so we can share just a little bit of their life with them on Easter morning like we'd like to. Brianna, would you put that on, please?
What does this mean? What is this?
A cross.
And what's that?
Equals sin.
What's heart. That? Love. The cross equals love, right?
Yeah.
Is this fun?
Yeah.
I'm captivated. Say it. I'm on a whole new retreat. My space invaded. Graded. I hear you talking.
Rules on Easter, and this marshmallow represents the body of Jesus, and I'm gonna put it. Then I'm gonna roll it up. Then roll it into a ball. And set it aside. And then my mom's gonna cook them. And whenever they're done, poof! Jesus rose from the dead.
Take two.
Yeah, baby!
Ready? One, two.
My only songs.
I needed someone to come rescue me. And mercy heard my plea. Lord, you found me, you healed me, you called me from the grave. You gave me a real love, I thank you, Jesus. You washed my sins away. And now I'm living like I'm forgiven. You came and set me free. That's what your mercy did for me.
What are you doing?
I'm playing with clear slime.
You know, that reminds me. The Bible says that if we ask God for forgiveness, he'll wash away our sins, making our sins as clear as this slime.
Happy Easter, everyone.
Happy Easter.
Yes, Jesus loves me, for the Bible tells me so.
Merry Mexican Sunday!
Amen. Okay. Well, thank you, parents. Thank you, kids, for making that video and bringing some joy to our lives. We miss all of you this morning. We always miss the kids. You know, we got a church full of kids, so it's real, real. We live great here because of the youth. What would a church be without kids? I always say that. What would you have? Pretty boring, wouldn't it? Amen. Well, I'm just going to pray over your offering, and we are going to go on with a little bit of a Christmas or Easter message today. Christmas. I'm in a different time zone, really. Teasing you. Father, thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to be in covenant. I pray the blessing, Lord. Blessing, blessing, blessing. Curse removed. Healing. An impartation of a good life, God. Bless your people this morning in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. At least I didn't say Merry Christmas, huh? Well, good to see all of you again. It's Resurrection Sunday. Got a word for you today. Just talking about, you know, I'm going to talk about a little bit about affliction, but mostly about resurrection. You know, affliction, I'm a numbers guy sometimes, and affliction is in the Bible 75 times. I just thought I'd throw that out there. However, blessing is in the Bible 183 times. So the ratio is obviously you have more blessing than you do cursing. And I look at what's going on, and I'm, you know, I'd like to have a way to look at it that's proper. And because I have learned to use every problem to push me further. Like I don't get stuck on what's going on. And sometimes, you know, when you're like that, people think you're ignoring the situation, but you're really not. You're using it as your way of learning, because all those things happen. We're celebrating Resurrection Day, but guess what? I had people in my life that died, you know, so the resurrection, seeking out God as the resurrection, was because there was death in my life somewhere. So, you know, I think you gotta have the starter to have the finisher. We like to just focus on the good stuff, but what the good stuff came because bad stuff was at the bottom, at the root. So I think you gotta be bold enough to look at the hard parts of your life so God can get in, and I am real big on that. You know, I've said this in other teachings that I did a financial, you know, counseling in class for people. And one of the people called the initial session shock and awe, because they never looked at their finances that close. And when they saw how much they owed and how much their payments were and how much their income was, excuse me, it created shock and awe. In other words, they didn't know where they were. Excuse me. And I think it is so important that you find out where you're located, because you can't get out until you locate yourself. Father, thank you this morning that this will be a location sermon, but it'll also be a victory sermon. I thank you, God, that you came and died and saved our life. And I thank you we'll enter into that reality this morning in Jesus' name. Anyway, so the basis is looking into where you're at. You know, God knew we would get off course. If you notice, when man's left to himself, he gets off course. That's why the Bible says it's not good for man to be alone. That's why the isolation, you know, it'll do some things, but some things it won't help, because you need people around you that can help you get located. See, if you live by yourself too long, I have found that when people live by themselves too long, they have a tendency to get selfish. Like if their husband dies and they're in their 60s, as the years go by, they get more selfish, more rigid, and more unwilling to change. And so they control their environment. They only go places where they can feel good about themselves. And if somebody's not doing what they like, they can't even take somebody being different. And they go, I don't want to be here. I want to go home. I mean, they're just gone. They can't take anything except themselves. So they eliminate people out of their lives. And when you do that, when you're left to yourself, you just kind of get more introverted and more messed up. So God intervenes in our life with things, and he tells us, he tries to bring things, and he, a lot of times he can't get them to us at peacetime, what I call, you know, good times. Because we're so busy with the good times, you know, we've all been so busy with the blessing that this having to stay home and having to deal with yourself is a real challenge. Dealing with yourself, it's easier to tell everybody else what to do. When it comes time to deal with yourself, you know, Pastor James and I have been going into prison for 15 or 16 years now. And the one thing that I've learned after all those years is when you go in there, you have to adapt to that life just like you were having to adapt to being in your house. And when you adapt to that life, you negotiate certain survival skills to live in a prison, and you adapt to your environment. But you certainly have a lot of time to know yourself and get to know yourself and get to know other people. Because in a lot of cases, you know, I don't figure those people have to talk to you nice. They don't have to massage you and make you feel good. They just tell you like it is because they don't know you. And if you don't want to hear it, you just probably don't have to listen, you know, because they're going to tell you the truth real quick. And it makes you face a reality. When people get into prison at first, I've watched several guys. They were still acting like they were on the outside. They were still trying to, you know, be cool and shuck and jive and dominate their sphere in the prison. And when I saw that, I thought, you just don't know you're here yet, because you don't know that this, what you're doing is totally irrelevant in this environment. And I think that when you change environments like we're changing, we're getting a reprioritization of what we need, what we don't need, how much time we spend doing this or that. Here's one for you, and I'm not saying, but how would you like it if the internet went down tomorrow too? Ooh, even nobody know what to do with themselves. But remember, it hasn't been around. I mean, they created that while I was, you know, living. It was prior to me, or in the middle of my life, it wasn't there anyway. So could you imagine if they shut everything down? Then you'd really have to figure out what you're going to do. How would you communicate, you know? Not saying it's going to happen, but I'm just telling you, it can always be harder. There's always another level of things that could create problems in your life. But anyway, we have learned by going to the prison, Pastor James and I, that when they come to themselves, they become very good disciples and good Christians in there. I'm sure some of them get jailhouse religion, but I wouldn't say all of them. I would say a lot of them develop a relationship with Jesus, and you can tell. And they learn what's relevant. You know, what was relevant on the outside isn't relevant on the inside. You know, you don't have the same needs. So you change your priorities, a new understanding of what is important. I'm not saying God did this virus. I'm just telling you that you can use it to locate yourself. Humanity, like I said, has a way of being miscalibrated, just being by itself. See, society without God gets miscalibrated. Like when you eliminate these truths, you eliminate your measuring tape. And it's funny, unfortunately, sometimes you don't know you build a bad house till you die. That's why you need to have people listen to preaching and hear the word and make the Bible a priority. Because you can build your whole house and it won't withstand anything. The storm that's going on right now, it'll help you understand whether your house is going to stand or not. Like, I'm not telling you that I like what happened, but it sure is a preliminary locator as to how you built your life and what your life is built on. You know, Jesus said, build it on a good foundation. So anyway, we've eliminated God. I'm not going to re-preach this sermon I've re-preached before, but, you know, we took God out of the schools. We've messed with the food. It doesn't have any nutrients in it. Everything we touch, we kind of mess it up. We always think we can know better because when man separates himself from God, he thinks he is God. He just can't admit it. But when you separate from God, that means you don't have anybody greater than you, and that means you're probably the greatest thing you got. And for you to do that is get you off course. When intellect takes over, instead of being subject to God, things get miscalibrated. Let's just put it that way. God gave us our intellect, but it is always supposed to be under the lordship of Jesus. You've heard me quote the scripture, for to be carnally minded is death, right? But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. The crucifixion, I don't think it can be understood with the mind. I think that the mind has to catch up by reading the scriptures about the crucifixion. Because I remember, you know, they said Jesus died for your sins, and I would get it like a distant look on my face because I could never understand what it really meant. You had to understand you were a sinner before you could appreciate the cross, you know. I've heard people say that the Bible is stories, like Noah's Ark is just a story. And, you know, avoid the stories that we read that we build our life on and try to have a life and calibrated life. But they always end up with miscalculated religion. And it I'm not just saying that. I mean, I've listened to people a lot over the years. Just because it doesn't fit in your head doesn't mean it's not true. Faith is a byproduct of believing the word of God. Let's go to Luke chapter 24. Okay? Now these people were with Jesus. They watched him do his miracles. They watched him feed the hungry. And they had all their hopes in him. Isn't it funny? These people had their hope in Jesus, but when he was crucified, they got totally bewildered. How many of you have been following God and something happened and there you are? You are totally bewildered. Here we go. On Luke 24, it says, on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared and certain others with them. In other words, they didn't finish the job. They came back to finish the burial, okay? And when they got there, they were picking up where they left. When they got there, they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre, and they entered in and found not the body of the Lord. You talk about a disappointment. Here, what you saw, you were going to go take care of because you weren't done. And when you get there, everything is completely changed. Have you ever prepared for something that never happened, that you never got to do? Some people have invested in businesses. Some people invested in marriages. Some people have invested in all kinds of things. And all of a sudden, when you go to do it, it's not there. It's abstract. Well, that will cause much broken heart and bewilderment. It says, and it came to pass, as they were perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Okay, they're perplexed. Obviously, they're not sure what to think. And you know you're vulnerable when you're perplexed sometimes, right? How many of you have been trying to, when you're perplexed, you're vulnerable, and you tell somebody how you feel, and then they crush you. Because you're vulnerable. When you're being honest with yourself, you become vulnerable to other people. And these guys say, this is really, really good. As they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth and said unto them, why do you seek the living among the dead? Isn't it interesting? These people knew Jesus and they were completely looking in the wrong direction at the time that all the things were happening that he said would happen. They knew him, they walked with him, and they were still 180 degrees out. Isn't that amazing how you could be a Christian, be filled with the Holy Ghost, talk in tongues, read your Bible, and have experience with Jesus and still not understand what he's going to do? They said, he's not here, but he has risen. And they knew how to calibrate the people. He said, remember how he spoke unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third day arise again. And they remembered his words. Now, just to touch that for a minute, what's more important, what you saw or what Jesus said? See, what Jesus said takes precedence over what you saw. He said it first, but if you don't value his words and you value your experiences, you won't remember what he said when you need to know it. His word has to be a priority to you. And they remembered his words. See, so that's why people around you help you remember scripture. They help you walk higher. And I'm going to say this. If the people you're walking with take you down, you need to reassess those relationships. Because the people aren't, you know, there are people that you almost got to get based to have a relationship with. And really, that you're supposed to help each other come up. Hallelujah. But when you know, if you don't want to change, you know, you get stubborn and everybody has to deal with you, has to deal with you at the level you want to be at that you don't want to grow. But anyway, that's a different sermon. So Mary Magdalene was there. Joanna and the mother of James and other women were with him, which I thought was real interesting, other women. Did you ever notice the women all gather around things sometimes and the men don't? I think the women seem to know what to be around. After all, Jesus used women to do a lot of things. And which they told unto the apostles, and their words seemed to them as idle tales, and they believed them not. These guys walk with Jesus, 12 disciples, 11, one of them betrayed him. They walk with him, they knew him, they saw what he did, they heard everything he said, and they don't have a clue what's going on. I just think that's amazing. I've been there. How many of you have been there? You had it all figured out in your head, but when it happens in front of you, it's kind of like this, you know. The Bible says that in the last days, you know, there's going to be pestilence and things. And I'm not saying we shouldn't be surprised, but it's written that it could happen. And so when it happens, see, I'm one of them preemptive guys. I like to be ready before things happen. I like to accept them as truths, and then they don't catch me so off guard. Because there's enough preparation. When you have a crisis or you have something, just look at all the work everybody's had to do to work at home. Move your computers, move all your stuff, communicate with your boss. It created a lot of work. It's nice if you have some of that done before you need it. Anyway, Peter, you got to love Peter. 12, he gets up and runs to see if it's true. At least he thought enough of what they said and said, I'm going to go check this out personally. Because I know these women, they don't lie. They may be wrong, but they don't lie, so I'm going to go check it out. You can say what you want about Peter, but I didn't see anybody else getting up to go see what happened. He owned what he believed enough. Even though he flaked out, he still owned it enough to go make an inspection to see if it was true. That's not a very passive personality. Peter wanted to know for himself. See, each of us have to know for ourselves. They all could have got up and went to the tomb. Every one of them. But only one thought enough to go make sure. He did his own due diligence so he'd know for himself. Hallelujah. He heard it, but he searched the scriptures like the Bereans. In other words, he was going to find out if it was true. He didn't just say, oh, okay, let's go play softball now. He didn't say, well, we got dinner at noon. He got up and ran to see whether it was true or not. Excuse me. Now, he also got bewildered. He departed wondering in himself because, you know, the tomb was empty. What was come to pass? And behold, two of them, that same day, to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 70 furlongs. And they talked. What do people do when they're in a crisis? They talk. They talk amongst themselves. This is so normal. This is so human to me. Like, I can picture, wonder what happened to him. Wonder what did we do? What did we believe all these years? What did we do? We followed this guy, left my wife and kids there at the, I sold my boats, left my fishing business, and here I am. I don't know what to do. The dream I had, what I thought was going to happen, didn't even come close. And you go to your buddy, do you know what are we going to do now? What's next? Excuse me. So they continued together. As they continued together, I'm in verse 15, Luke 24, 15. And reasoned. Have you ever done all that? Reasoned over and over and over. Sometimes I reason the same thing 52 times. I wonder what's wrong with me. Nobody's ever done it. Say the same thing over and over and over and over and over. Cycle it. Amen. So Jesus himself drew near to them while they were talking, while they were communing. But their eyes were holden. In other words, they did not know who he was. Only Jesus could do that. Only God could do that. They can camouflage you right when you're next door. Amen. That means he can get you out of trouble. Don't ever forget that. He can hide you. I'll tell you a little story real quick. Dimitri Dudeman, I was listening to his persecution story. They electrocuted him 3 times and he didn't die. But that's another topic. They tried to kill him. The communists tried to kill him 3 times. They just couldn't do it. And he was smuggling Bibles. And he got to the border and he had Bibles in his trunk and it was loaded. And the guy said, open your trunk. He opened the trunk and there was Bibles all over the place. And the Lord told him before he got there, I'm going to hide them Bibles for you. And they never saw the Bibles and he closed the trunk and they let him into the country. I just heard that story from somebody else on YouTube that God hid the Bibles from the people who were. That's the second time that I've heard God hide to hide. The guys literally just can't see it. So surely Jesus can cloak himself so you couldn't see him. If he can hide Bibles to the naked eye. But anyway, that was a great story. If you're into smuggling some Bibles, you might keep that in the back of your mind there. Amen. So he asked them a question. When God asks you a question, it's to locate you. He knows what they're saying. He says, what manner of communication are these that you have one with another as you walk and are sad? In other words, what are you talking about? He says, what are you talking about? Now, what I thought was interesting, and it was very convicting. You ever read a Bible, get all convicted by yourself? Jesus let him talk. And see, I have a tendency to be a fixer, and I try to fix people about halfway through their conversation. Jesus let them tell their whole side of the story. The whole thing. The whole thing. And one of them said, whose name was Cleophas, answering him, are you the only stranger in Jerusalem that has not known the things which come to pass there in these days? Isn't it interesting? They're talking to the guy they crucified, and they're going, you're the only guy that don't know? That's what they did. And he's the one that they killed. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And he said unto them, what things? He's still asking them questions. My goodness. Now, you would think God, since he's so powerful, he would just tell us to listen. Instead, he lets us talk. Remember that when you're praying. As crazy as it sounds, he's going to listen to your story. As crazy as you are, I've been crazy, and he's listened to my story. I've lived this. This is easy for me. I've come in God's presence nuts, and he listened me out. Not like people. He'll hear your side. You don't have to be right. Isn't it interesting? He's so loving and kind. You don't even have to be right. But he'll let you talk. Hallelujah. Anyway. And they said, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, and he's a prophet. He was a prophet. Mighty indeed, in word before God, all the people. And how the chief priests and the rulers delivered him to be condemned to death and have crucified him. Boy, what a story. What a bad story. Now, here's the big, big one for you. Trust is how you live with God, right? Really. If you don't trust God, you can't receive from God. But we trusted that it had been he which should have redeemed Israel. In other words, all our hopes were hung on one thing. Our entire life and hopes were hung on the one thing we believed. Scary to get there, isn't it? They sold out. They walked with him. They did the best they could, and they were sold out, but they forgot what he told them. Now's a good time to remember your prophecies, recap your scriptures, get out the words that were spoken over your life. Don't let the words, the written word, the rhema word, and the prophetic words, don't forget about them now. Now's when you need the reference points, because they're still going to come to pass regardless of the circumstances. All this was hanging on one thing. And they said, beside all this, today is the third day since these things were done. And now women came and told him, he's not even there. His body's gone. It got worse. He's gone, like he never existed. When they didn't find his body, they came saying they had a vision of angels, which was said that he was alive. And certain of them which went with him to the sepulcher found even as the women had said, but him they saw not. In other words, he's missing. Not only did it not come out right, we don't even know where he went. Everything's unfinished. Everything's undone. We don't know what's going to happen next. We don't even know what we were going to do because we based our whole life on what he was doing. Jesus' answer. O fools, slow of heart to believe. Listen to what he said to believe. All that the prophets have spoken. In other words, you are looking at all that's happening and you have forgot about everything he told you. How many times have we gotten caught up in the hoopla of the news and the media and our own personal experiences and all the things we think about, but we forget about what he said. In other words, he told us this was going to happen. We were ready. But we didn't remember what he said because we switched from listening to watching. If you watch too much, you'll really get confused. Big time. He said, remember the things I told you. And then he is, this is so convicting. Wouldn't you like to be able to do this? Verse 27. I'm sure he quoted books and chapters or whatever. And beginning at Moses, he started with Moses. And all the prophets expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. He showed them his whole, he quoted the scripture and showed him his whole life and took him from the end to the beginning. He took him straight to the word. And they drew nigh unto the village where they went. And he made as though he would have gone further. In other words, he says, well, I got to keep going. But he was persuaded. See, I don't know about you. That means I could persuade him to stay with me. I could persuade him. My prayers and supplications will persuade him to do something else in my situation. My God. It's wonderful. But they constrained him, saying, abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them. He went with them. And it came to pass, as he sat to meat with them, he took bread and blessed it, and broke it and gave it to them. Their eyes were opened. I'm reading my Bible in front of you. I'm sorry. That whistle was like, wow. I mean, I'm enjoying the word here. And they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight. When your eyes are opened, everything looks different. They went from being sad to being glad in a moment when their eyes were opened. You know, sometimes when you're in a storm, you just can't see. But the scriptures will open your eyes. What has God said concerning you? He will give his angels charge over thee. Jehovah Jireh cares for you. Hallelujah. We can go through the head, not the tail, blessed above and not beneath. No sick, no plague come nigh your dwelling. I have plans for your good, not for your evil, for your success, blessing you, not for cursing. We can rehearse all the scriptures and turn the way we see things. Excuse me. They rose up the same hour and returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 gathered together and them with him, saying, the Lord is risen indeed, and he has appeared unto Simon. And they told him all those things. And verse 36 says, and as they spoke thus they spoke, Jesus himself stood in the midst of them and said unto them, peace unto you. But they were terrified and affrighted and supposed they had seen a spirit. Interesting. He shows up and they're scared to death, literally. And he said unto them, why are you so troubled? And why do thoughts arise in your hearts? Behold my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Handle me and see, for a spirit has not flesh and bones as you see me have. He has to identify himself. They're so shook up, they can't relate. They can't relate. You ever been there? Did you ever have a problem and somebody tries to start talking to you the answer and you just can't hear any of it? You heard them, but you, and then you go call somebody else and you hear them and it didn't do any good. Then you just try to read your Bible and you can't. Nobody's ever been there before. You've never thought that way before, that you've tried to get something and you just can't get anywhere. Thank you. Amen. So he goes on to prove it. He says, have you any meat? And so he eats in front of them. And he said unto them, these are the words which I spoke unto you while I was yet with you, that all this must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses and in the prophets and the Psalms concerning me. Then opened he their understanding. My God, how many would like to have that happen? Jesus can do it for you. That's what I'm trying to tell you this morning. He did it. He said it all before he was crucified. And then after he was crucified, he came to explain it. Then when he left, he sent the Holy Ghost to help you. And he said, this is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things. And behold, I send the promise of my Father unto you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high. Hallelujah. And as he led them, I love that word led. And as he led them, he was leading them again. Out as far as Bethany, he lifted up his eyes and his hands and blessed them. And it came to pass while he blessed them, he was parted from them and carried up into heaven. And they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy and were continually in the temple praising and blessing God. Amen. Jesus came when they didn't understand, and he quoted the scriptures and adjusted all their thinking and gave them peace and understanding. And I believe God wants to do that for you today. I think that he cleared up why he came. You know, they thought he was going to do it one way and God did it another. Does that ever sound familiar to you? He never seems to do it the way you think it's going to come to pass. I'll say this now. I mean, Pastor James knows this. We've been wanting to name the worship team for years, you know, never knew what to say. Just never could get it worked out. Well, somebody says, I believe Lord wants to call it Restoration Worship. And we all looked at each other and we all knew, you know why? God spoke. Now, we could have wrote names, made t-shirts. We could have put names all over everything and it wouldn't have been any as good. It wouldn't have been anywhere near as good as when God said Restoration Worship. And the anointing came and we all knew. He cleared up. We've been in ministry 20 years and God cleared up in one sentence after 20 years of work what See, at the appointed time, he tells you. Don't worry about the times when you don't know, but just don't switch sides on God. You might be bewildered, but you don't have to be hopeless. You might not know what's going on, but you don't have to quit. Stay in there. Stay with it. God will define it to you. He will define it to you. He will define this to us too someday. Don't you know that sometimes you have to look back to understand what happened? You need some time between you and it. Those guys that we're talking about in the prison, sometimes they lived on such a whirlwind, they don't even know what happened to them until they go to prison. Then they have time to reflect on it. God has some time to talk. God had time to talk to these people on the road to Emmaus because their purpose, they didn't have nothing to do. They was with him, and he was gone. And I'm going to say this about the time you have right now. I encourage you, in the name of Jesus, to make the most of your time right now. I promise you, as we're all sitting here today and you're sitting out there, all the things he's revealing are the things you're going to have to change more than likely. Everything that's not working right shows up in this. This is why soldiers train all the time in peacetime so they don't have problems in crisis. If you were having a lot of problems in your crisis, you were not ready for God to do the next thing. I am sorrowful of all the deaths, and we are praying for people. As a matter of fact, you guys know this. God warned us, and we prayed over everybody that's connected to this ministry about a week before we had our last service where public came. God got us ready. But I promise you, he didn't make us exempt from the things where we're not ready. We're going to have to go through what we need to go through to be ready for what he wants to do next. And we're going to find all our faults, all our flaws, and all our foundations that need shored up to do a good job and to do what he wants to do in the next place. Now, if you're not having those challenges, that's great. You might have it all worked out. But it doesn't look that way most of the time to me. It looks like all the people are having to make their adjustments now. They're having to live with each other. We were joking yesterday we weren't joking a week ago when we said it, but we should run some marriage counseling videos somewhere because these people are having to live with each other and all having to deal with each other now and all this stuff. And it's really hard for them because most of them have worked and both people have worked and nobody's really had to deal with much. I mean, you might laugh. Your leaky faucet probably bothers you more now than it ever did if you have one. Your stuff that's broken, your house probably bothers you more now because you're using it more and you go to use it, it's not working, and so you get annoyed. Well, you never had the time to think about it. You were always busy getting ready, going to where the whirlwind. The whirlwind has stopped for now. Now you have to look at yourself and you have to look at your life and your circumstances. Don't waste the opportunity complaining. Don't waste the opportunity hoping it changes. Don't miss the window to fix it. God will define it to you. Well, Jesus saved our life. These guys didn't know it. But when he visited them, they knew exactly what happened. He defined it to them. God is going to have a definition for all of us in this. He's going to teach us some things we don't know that need to be done. And after we do all our gyrations and we do everything we think we're going to do, he's probably going to talk then. So, Father, this morning, we thank you for the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the one who came and died for our sins. I'll stop right here for just a minute. If that is you and you have never accepted Jesus, when I say accepted Jesus, you have to accept what he said. In other words, Jesus is right, and our lifestyles are wrong if they don't line up with the Word of God. It's called sin. And Jesus died to take care of the areas where you sinned. But if you think about it, if you go back and sin again after he took care of those sins, you're nullifying the effect of the cross in your life. Because how can he go to the cross again? He said it's finished. And your ability to say you're wrong and your ability to say that I'll confess my sins empowers him to forgive your sins. He's whoever sins, confesses in sins, he will forgive him of his sins and cleanse him from all unrighteousness. If you're living in sin and you're a Christian today, God and wants to deal with you. We're celebrating Resurrection Day, but there's a second resurrection. And it's not for everybody. It's for everybody, but there's the resurrection of the dead and the resurrection of the living. If you're not ready for the second resurrection, take this time to make your adjustment. You have to decide that you're going to do what you're going to put Jesus first. He gave his life for you. And you have to tell him you're sorry of your sin, because you guys know this. There's just as many stats of Christians sinning as there is sinners sinning. I'm not making an excuse for sinners, but if they're ignorant, I don't think it's anywhere near as convicting or bad. But when you willingly sin, when you've known the difference, you're at a different level of accountability. And if that's you, I want you to pray with me today. Father, we come in Jesus' name again. We acknowledge that we are Christians and that we backslid. And we turned away from the living God to serve our own desires. Jesus, forgive us for trampling on your cross. Forgive us for not putting it first. And we thank you this morning for taking us back. And we repent of those sins. And we ask you, God, to clean us up emotionally, whatever, how dirty we got emotionally from sinning. I thank you that you will cleanse us again and our right standing will be renewed. And if you're here, if it's for the first time that you're going to accept Jesus, God is going to give you eternal life today. You literally are going to switch from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light, from heaven to hell, or from hell to heaven, the absolutes. Father, I come in Jesus' name. I acknowledge that you are right and I am wrong. I acknowledge my sin. And I confess my sins to you. And I thank you that my name will be written in the eternal life book, permanent life. God, help me find a church. Give me a desire to read the word this morning and help me have fellowship. In Jesus' name, amen. If that's you and you would like some help with your newfound faith, your new Christianity, I believe there'll be something on the screen for you to call, to read, to text, even a prayer thing. But the point is, we want to connect with you. If nothing, you're going to laugh. You can just Google us and you can find us on the internet if you really want to connect. Be like Peter. Go check it out for yourself. Don't take somebody else's word for it. Check it out for yourself. Check us out. You're new and you need a Bible, we'll mail you a Bible. You need to pray, we'll pray with you. We'll do whatever you need at the moment. We want to connect. I always say, we don't do this for something to do. We do this because we believe it in our heart. And that heartfelt belief is what pushes us to do the things to reach people. You think about it. If I was thought believed that I was going to hell, which I was, and now I believe I'm not, what kind of person would I be not to tell you that you don't have to go either? Wouldn't be very valuable, would I? Wouldn't be very caring or loving. If you claim to be a Christian and you claim to be loving, you can't let your friends go to hell and not tell them about Jesus. You know, you got to pray for openings. Pray for opportunities. Amen. Well, we thank you this morning for letting us share some things with you on this Resurrection Sunday. I realize it wasn't all about the resurrection, but see, there was suffering before the resurrection, and somehow I think you got to have the connection. I believe that you have to connect with people who are in pain, and I try to make it a habit never to not feel the pain that people feel so I can identify with them. The identifying with people is how you help people. You can't preach for them or talk to them like afar off. You have to connect. Well, Father, thank you for this time. I pray over everybody that's listening to this broadcast. Give them grace to obey the laws of man and the laws of God. I thank you, God, that the virus is diminishing in Jesus' name. I command it to diminish. I speak to it. Can't help it, God. That's what you said to do. Speak to the virus. I thank you that nobody connected with this ministry gets sick, no matter how many rest homes they work in. No matter how many public places they go to work in, I thank you, God. They will be free from sickness and disease in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful day with whatever family you feel proper assembling so you don't pass the numbers game. and enjoy Resurrection Day. Amen.